Hit record. So there we go. Okay. Now let me get us going. Okay. Very good. Well, let's see if we can get through the diagram here so we can make more progress getting back to our John passage. But I thought what we could do today, this morning, first off, is to do one more example from Ephesians, and then go to John and do a passage from John 4, diagram it, and see where that takes us today. Okay, so this is just all reviewing here with recognizing that epistles in paragraphs, and then we've already talked about the last several weeks the sentence. That's one clause which expresses a complete thought and can often have other phrases and clauses that modify within the sentence. And again, remember, we have the clause is made up of, it contains a subject and a verb. That's the main difference between a clause and a phrase. A clause has a subject and a verb and therefore could express a complete thought. A phrase cannot express a complete thought because it does not have both a subject and a verb. All right, so now there are two types of clauses. There's the clause that makes a complete statement by itself, a complete thought. That's an independent clause. And then there's the dependent one. That's where it does have a subject and a verb, but it doesn't stand by itself. Okay, we've looked at several examples of those. So hopefully those are clear to you. So again, the subject, the verb, the object, we've talked about those. Just think of these things in terms of action or state of being, where the subject does the action, the verb is the action, the object is the recipient of the action, or as we've discussed, participates in the action. Now, as I've said also, there are two kinds of verbs. There's the action verbs that describe some activity. I listened, I heard, I walked, I hit, those kinds of things. I know. And then there are the verbs that describe a state of being or a condition. He is, they are, we will be. Okay. So, and those don't have objects because there's no action. It's describing a state. When you're describing the state of something, it's not doing an action. So if I'm looking outside and I see trees, I could say the tree is tall. Well, the tree's not doing an action. I'm telling you a state of the tree, the condition of the tree. So I say it is tall. So in that case, there's no object. But when I use that sentence, the tree is tall, there is a word here that's describing the subject. In this case, the subject is the tree. And tall is what we would call, in this case, a predicate adjective. That is, it describes the subject of the clause, and it follows the verb of being. Again, there's the verb of being, is. All right. Now, if I were to say, like there's examples in scripture of the trees clap their hands. Okay, now, do trees have hands? They don't. This is a figure of speech here. But in this case, there is an action happening where the subject is doing an action, clapping. Now, again, it's figurative, but claps their hands. So their hands would be the object. That is, they're participating in the action. So the tree is doing the action. The action itself is clap. And the object is their hands. But when I say the tree is tall, I'm, again, not describing an action. So there's two kinds of verbs that we have. Those that are action verbs. And then those that describe a state or a condition, okay? So that's why we have here the object. That will be what describes what the subject is doing, if it's an action, or a predicate adjective, predicate nominative, all right? Now, predicate adjective is, it's an adjective. It describes the subject, which is a noun. A predicate nominative is a noun. So if I were to say, the man is a doctor. Okay. then now I've got, again, it's a verb of being. There's no action here to state. And this man is a doctor. So in this case, since this is a noun, it's not an adjective, I call it a predicate nominative. All right, so that's the difference. And in this case, basically, what it means is this, that I'm saying the man equals a doctor, okay? So, but it's a noun. That's why it's predicate nominative. So just keep the, you know, I send you the handout. I have this on the handout. So just keep that handy with you. I'm just trying to review a few things because I think it's really important. Because what, at the end of the day, what we're trying to do is identify the main sentence, which is an independent clause. So we'll have a subject and a verb and an object or this predicate adjective or nominative. You're going to see those three components most of the time when you have an independent clause, and that makes up the sentence. And that's what we're looking for at the beginning when we're diagramming this independent clause, this main sentence. Okay, so we've gone through a number of examples. And you can look at the previous videos, the last few sessions, if you want to review that, to look at those examples. And then we got to some examples from, and here's where I make the statement, the goal is to identify the independent clause of the paragraph and then see how the rest of the clauses and phrases relate. And so we did several examples of that. I want to do one or two more from Ephesians, and then we'll move on to our passage in John, okay? And as we did last week, I'm going to just ask, calling you and ask for you to identify the independent clause and then tell me from that independent clause, that is again, subject, verb, sometimes an object, it's the main one that forms a complete thought. From that independent clause, tell me the subject, verb, and object. And then we will look at additional phrases and clauses that you see there. All right. So hopefully you can see this, Ephesians chapter 6. Pastor Bobby, you're at the top, so we're going to start with you. If you could read the text, then identify the independent clause and the subject, verb, object from that clause, and then we will look at the phrases.
Okay. First is, be strong in the Lord. Okay? It's an independent clause with implied subject. You.
Okay. So that's the, you're saying the independent clause is be strong in the Lord. Is that correct?
Uh-huh.
And then you is the...
Correct. Is that correct, Pastor Tim?
Well, we'll walk through it here. So you is the subject and it's implied. You're right.
Yes.
Because this is a command.
Yes.
Okay. Good. And then the verb?
Be strong.
Okay, the verb here, be.
Mm-hmm.
And now a strong part of the verb, is it an object or is it something else?
The object is strong.
Okay, so here we ask ourselves the question, Is strong functioning as an object here? Is it receiving an action or participating in an action?
Or is it part of the, it is part of the action. It looks like it is part of the action, Pastor Tim.
It's part of the action, or what could be another option? So there's two options here. Strong is part of the action. Be strong. Or what's another possibility? What kind of verb is this? Is this an action verb or a verb of being, a state or condition?
It's a condition.
Yeah. So then it could be, strong could be what? Not an object, but a...
A
state of being.
Okay, it's describing... Something
verb, predicate adjective, sir.
Predicate adjective. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Now, we're going to do so it could be a predicate adjective, again, because it's not, he didn't say
you be active.
getting strong.
Well, I'm trying to think of, yeah, you get strong, or that's not even a good get. Yeah, we could say that, and I guess in a sense, you get a
you get strength.
A Bible, you get strength. Yeah, that would still be get. I would say this: get some weights to make yourself strong. There you go. Now this would be an action. Okay. You get some weights. Where you is the subject, get would be the verb, and then weight is the recipient of the action, because get is an active verb. It's describing an action, right? Mm-hmm. Whereas in this case, you be strong, that's telling you to be a certain state. Mm-hmm. Be in a state of strength, be strong. So it's either the strong is functioning either as a predicate adjective. Here, I'll mm-hmm. write it out. Meaning it's an adjective that's describing the subject, because I have a verb of being here, be, or it's possible this could be a whole verbal idea. Now, English is kind of tricky. How would we know if the verb is be strong or just be? Is there anything we could do to try to figure that out?
Check interlinear.
Yeah, we could do two things. First, let's check out the other translations just to see what they do. Okay, so I'll come over and we'll look at translation here. What are we in? Ephesians chapter 6. And we're in verse 10. So as we look at, this is the New King James. Finally, my brethren, be strong. Okay, same as the New American Standard. The ESV, be strong in the Lord. The NIV, be strong in the Lord. The Net Bible, be strengthened. Ah, that's interesting. So, four of the English translations say be strong, which makes it seem like a strong is a predicate adjective. But notice the Net Bible has be strengthened. That's both words together are a verb, where be here is functioning like, we call it a helping verb. Because these two words, be and strengthened, are both verbs. Okay?
Yes, I remember. So, they are helping verbs.
Yeah, helping verbs are is, has, I, you know, or be, they can function that way where they're combined with another verb. And so that's why we call them a helping verb. So the way that, as Sid had mentioned, what we can do is look at, so now we have a clue here that, maybe because one of the five English translations put be strengthened rather than be strong. So let's consider then interlinear, and I'm going to have to pull that up in a minute. You can go online to blueletterbible.org or to biblehub.com. What I can do here is, actually, I have an interlinear on this. Let's see.
You know, sometimes, Pastor Tim, if you go to the interlinear, it would just be one word.
Yes. So here, I don't know if you guys can see this easily. I have verse 10. Can you guys see my arrow? Everyone see my arrow? Down here, I've got the Greek, and it's finally be strong. And then notice, let's see if I can make this. Be strong in the Lord. Here, let's get over to there. Sorry. Notice here, be strong is one word in the Greek. In the Lord, there's the rest. So in the Greek, it looks like be strong is actually the whole verb.
All right. Bennett Bible correct.
What's that? Oh, somebody's turning on Logos. So let's just do that. Now, if you don't have Bible software or something like that, what we can do then is go to our interlinear.
Yeah.
And let me see if I can do this.
Endunamuo.
Yes. Okay, why can't I?
The Greek word endunamuo.
Okay. Oh, here's James. Okay. Let's see if I can. So we'll go to, I don't know, hope, can you see my internet? Can you guys see it? Bible Hub?
Yeah, Bible Hub.
Okay. So I'm going to go to, I'm in Ephesians. So I'm going to go to Ephesians. I'm going to go to chapter 6.
Verse 11.
All right. And then I'm going to hit the interlinear, which is right here, interlin. And then I'll just click the chapter here. So hopefully you can see what I'm doing here. Now I'm clicking the chapter because I want to see all the verses. It makes it a little easier. And then I'm going to scroll down to verse 10. 8, 9, and 10. Okay. Now, hopefully, I'll try to expand this a little bit. Notice here, again, the middle, the large font in the middle, the black letters, that's the actual Greek text. And then at the very top's the Strong's number for the word. Below it is the English form of the Greek word, just so we could pronounce it, en dynamousta. And then the red is the dictionary definition. And then below that, we have the parts of speech here. And notice, if you can see it, it says verb, present, middle, second person plural. All right? So present imperative. So we know this is an imperative. It's my verb. And then notice it contains the idea of be empowered. So that be strong is actually the whole verb in two words in English. Be strengthened, actually, then from the Net Bible is probably a better way to translate it, because it tells us that it's all one verbal idea. All right? Get empowered, be strengthened. And notice, in the Lord, it says after that. So there's no, there's a separate Greek word for be. It would be a me. All right? But we don't see that here. We don't see the word a me, and then I forget the noun for strong, or the word for strong in Greek. I think it is that's in dunama,
Indunamuo, Pastor Tim.
No, that's the verb. I'm trying to think of the adjective, but this is the verb. All right. And so what we see here is that actually the interlinear tells us that it's not be strong, it's be strengthened. All right. It's be empowered, be given strength to do something.
So it's in the passive mode.
Yes. All right. Let's go back to can everybody see this from the interlinear? Maybe give me a thumbs up if that makes sense, all right? We just went to Bible Hub and looked up the word, and there weren't two Greek words here that were be and then strong. There's one Greek word here that all of it carries the idea of be empowered. And so if you'll remember, let's go back to our notes. If you'll remember that in class we talked about this idea of um, the verb we were looking for with verbs, we have three characteristics: mood, voice. Okay, so more nosebleed today, guys. I'm sorry. We're going to do some English grammar here. But you guys are ready. You guys are ready for this. You're becoming English experts, all right? So I know this. You can handle this, all right? So the verbs,
Mr. Tim, we will be strong.
You will be strong. Yes, brothers, be strong in the grammar that we are learning. Okay, let's just review this because Pastor Bobby brought up a very, very important point just as we're trying to interpret a passage. So I think it's good to bring it up here. Because what we're dealing with is, okay, the verb, the whole verb then is be strengthened. Or, you know, the NAS has be strong, but now that we looked at the interlinear, we realized that this came from one Greek verb. Okay? So it carries this idea of be strengthened, or as we saw in the interlinear, it said be empowered. Okay, that's another. So let's understand this for a minute. All right. This is actually skipping to the next step. After you do the diagram, then what I have you do is look at the verbs and you break the verbs down by their three characteristics. All right. So let's do the three key characteristics of verbs. All right. Verbs have what's called a mood. All right. That doesn't mean they're like a mood, like an emotion, like they're moody, like they're emotional, but they do express this idea of there's a certainty or lack of certainty in the verb. So for example, one kind of verb is called the imperative. And what is the imperative?
Command.
It's a command, right? To do something, you're being commanded to do something. All right, that's called an imperative. We have another kind of verb.
Subjunctive mood.
Yeah, I'll do that one last because that's a little more complicated. I'll let you explain that one, Sid, when we get to it, all right? Let's do a couple more easier ones first. Indicative, all right? Who remembers what's an indicative? A verb that's indicative.
It's indicating.
It's indicating.
It's statement.
A statement.
Yeah.
Or a declaration.
Declaring something.
So, for example, let me shrink this. For example, we could say, so an imperative would be, run home. Okay? That's a command. You run home. An indicative would be I
ran home.
Ran or I run home or I ran home. It's making a statement. Okay? You're just declaring something as true, as factual. All right? Now, another type is an interrogative, which is interrogative. You can tell
asking
me what
questions.
It's a question.
Asking questions.
So did you run home? Exactly. And then we have a question mark to help us out, but that's another mood. There's uncertainty. I don't know. Indicative is I know. I did this. Interrogative is I'm not sure. It's in the form of a question. An imperative is a command to tell someone else to do it. Then we have what's called, all right, Sid, here you go. Can you describe, what is this mood? Subjunctive. What's a subjunctive mood?
If you're subjective.
It's not there's a conditional, that's what Pastor Noor's mentioning, and that is, if you run, all right, there's a condition, but on the subjunctive, What's a subjunctive mood? It is that of
pop. It is dependent on the subject.
Dependent on the subject, it's okay. It kind of carries the idea, there's less certainty. It carries the idea of possibility. So we might.
It's more like a certain hypothetical.
Potentially. I might run.
Yeah.
I may run. I should run. Those would be subjunctive. They're not certain. They are.
I ought to run.
What's that?
I ought to run.
I ought to run. Yeah, those carry the idea of there's less certainty, okay? A possibility, all right? And then conditional is it's conditioned upon something else happening, okay? Depends upon something else, all right? So as we consider this then, what we want to do is, as we look at the verbs, they're going to be one of these five. This is going to be, let me do it this way. There's going to be one of these five conditions or characteristics, excuse me, of the verb. So well, that didn't help me. I'm trying to make this a little more easier to follow here. Okay, I'm going to do this. Bear with me. I want to make it these five moods more clear. Okay, there we go. Okay, so you see we've got five moods here. Now, the more common is the imperative, indicative, interrogative, the subjunctive. If you see English words like might or may, should, ought, those are telling you there's not certainty involved. If it said I run, that's a statement of certainty. That's indicative. It indicates something. But if it's I might run, then we don't know if the action is going to take place. So that we call that the subjunctive mood. All right? So these are the five moods. Now, as we look at this verb, be strengthened, what mood is that?
Imperative.
Imperative mood.
It's imperative. It's a command.
Command.
You be strengthened. Okay? So, be strengthened. Imperative. All right. Now, let's look at the voice of a verb. Now, again, that doesn't mean verbs talk, but there are essentially two voices. There's what's passive. Called the
active and passive.
Passive and active.
The active voice and the passive voice. All right. Now, an active voice means that the subject is doing the action. Now, a passive voice is the action is done to the subject.
The subject is the receiver of the action.
Yeah, now that might sound like an object because that's how we defined object earlier. So let's look at an example here. So for example, if I were to say I shot the basketball. All right, tell me, what is the what is the subject here?
I.
And the verb?
Shot.
The verb is shot.
A shot or through the basketball. And the object is the basketball. That is the receiver of the action. Now, what if I were to change the sentence to this? The basketball was shot by me. Now, what is the subject?
Basketball.
The basketball is. But the basketball is receiving the action. The action was shot.
Was shot.
Okay. Now there's no object here.
Yes.
Because by me is a
phrase
that says how the ball was shot. All right? It's not an object in this case. You're saying, oh, man, this is getting complicated. Yes, I apologize for my language. It's complicated at times. But I think this is really, really important to see this because it's not just English, men. Greek does this. There's a passive voice in Greek. Mm-hmm. And Greek actually adds. So let me just finish with this one. So the example here of the passive, that is where the action is done to the subject. That's my key difference here. Where here is the subject. The subject is doing the action. All right. I, subject, shot the basketball. But in this case, the basketball is now the subject of the sentence, but the action is being done to it. It's no longer the object. It was the object in this sentence, but now when I word it this way, I made it the subject. Now, let's think about this a minute, interpreting wise. If the author chooses to make a passive sentence, where notice the action's happening to the subject, as you compare these two sentences, where's the emphasis? Look at, I shot the basketball. The emphasis is on I in this sentence.
On I, the subject.
The subject. The subject's always the primary
received the emphasis.
Person or thing in the sentence. The verb's the primary action. The subject's the primary focus of that action. And notice here in this sentence, what did I make the focus on?
Basketball.
On this sentence. Now the focus is on the basketball. All right. So by making a pass switch from active to passive, I'm changing the focus. All right. We'll go back to this verb be strengthened in a minute, and I'll show you why this is important. So here we have an example of the passive voice of a verb. That is where the action is being done to the subject. All right. So in both cases, our focus is on the subject. In fact, I'll just highlight it. All right. But in this case, with an active voice, it's the subject doing the action. With a passive voice, the action is happening to the subject. Now, Greek adds a third. We don't have this in English in the verb. A middle voice. That is the action is done by the subject to itself or for its benefit. Okay? For some of you who might, this term might mean something, it's called reflexive. All right? So, the idea would be let's see, how could I do it with this one?
I did it to myself.
Yeah, I, all right, I shot myself. All right, there you go. that would be the way English might express it. Or they gave themselves a ride.
Shut.
They shot themselves. Okay. So here,
suicide.
This might be the idea is the action is happening. The subject's doing the action. So again, we got the subject, I. Subject's doing the action, but it's for the benefit or being done to itself or for its benefit. In this case, it's not for my benefit, but I did it to myself. Now, in English, we express this idea with these what we call reflexive pronouns, but basically myself, himself, themselves, herself. That's the way the English expresses this idea of an action done for the benefit of oneself or doing it to oneself. Okay?
Very selfish.
Very selfish. So this is a Greek thing. And what you'll see in English translations is they'll try to add this pronoun, myself, yourself, ourself, in order to convey this idea of a middle. If I go back to you'll see this sometimes in the interlinear. When you're looking at the verb, it'll say middle. This is what it's saying, is that Greek actually changes the way a verb is the spelling of the verb. It adds a different few letters in it in order to convey this idea of the voice. All right? So in the Greek, the voice is actually seen by a change in how the verb is spelled. It's a different conjugation, so to speak. So the verb will have a different way that it's spelled depending on the voice. And in Greek, there's three voices, passive, middle, and active. In English, we only have a passive or active voice, and then the middle voice idea is expressed with these, this pronoun. So when you see a pronoun like that in a sentence where the subject is doing something to itself or for itself, that's a middle voice idea. Does this make sense? Are there any questions?
Mr. Tim.
Yes, sir.
Can we do it? They themselves gave a ride?
No, that would
become a positive.
They themselves gave a ride. This sentence puts emphasis on the subject. So in other words, they themselves, those people, gave a ride. This sentence, they gave themselves a ride, is the idea of they did something for themselves. This second sentence, they themselves gave a ride, just puts emphasis on they're the ones giving the ride. Now, if you had said they themselves gave a ride for themselves, that would add the idea. But you'll see this in Hebrew, where you'll see this, where you ever see those prophecies where it says, like you'll say, I myself declare this, says the Lord. Right? Have you seen that? Something like that? This is not a middle voice. What it is it's emphasizing that the pronoun myself is inserted for emphasis. God is saying here, I, me, myself, God is declaring this. So it's like an exclamation point.
It becomes antecedent.
So yeah, that's a different idea. But if God, if it said something like, if the statement was, I did this for myself, now that's a different, that's the middle voice, that something, he did something for his benefit or for himself. All right. So the key is to really focus on the active and the passive. The active is the subject's doing the action. So you could think of it this way. I shot the ball. Okay. The action's happening. The subject's doing the action. In this one, the basketball was shot by me. Okay, see, now the focus is back on the subject. The action's happening to the subject. So let's take a look again at our verb now. We have be strengthened. It's a command, it's in the imperative. Now, what voice is it? So this is the mood. What is the voice of this verb?
Passive.
It is passive.
Passive voice.
Because notice, he didn't say, give strength in the Lord. That would be active. He said, be strengthened. That means...
So that's the NET Bible, Pastor Tim.
That was the NET Bible. Yeah, the NAS and the others say be strong.
Yeah.
But that be strong doesn't really convey what is the idea here. He's saying receive strength. Be strengthened. Yeah. He's not saying, and here's why I'm going into all this, man, the passive voice is so important to see here because it tells you what's going on with, okay, what's the subject? You be strengthened in the Lord. Or that verb could be, that preposition could be translated by the Lord. Okay?
By context also, Pastor Tim, right?
Yeah, we'll get to that in a minute. But okay. Here, just look at the grammar of this sentence, all right? And the context is going to support this. You be strengthened. Now, if this were active, where is the strength coming from?
The Lord.
Well, no, if this were active voice.
The Lord strengthen you.
From the subject.
If it were active voice, the subject's doing the action. Okay? Remember, active voice.
Active.
You'll be strong.
The subject does the action. So in this case, the strength would come from the subject. If it's active. Active means subject doing the action. If it's passive voice, the action is being done to the subject. So in this case, the strength is given to the subject by something or someone else. You see the difference? He's not saying, when Paul says, here, finally, be strong, or like I said, I like the Net Bible better, be strengthened in the Lord. He's not saying, okay, you need to find the strength in yourself. You're the source of the strength. He's not saying that. If it were active voice, then he is saying that. But it's passive voice, meaning be strengthened from someone or by someone else. Now, in this sentence, we're told directly, you be strong in the Lord. Get your strength from the Lord. Mm-hmm. Okay? But if it had just said be strong, it still would be, you're not gaining the strength yourself. You're not getting it yourself. You're not producing that strength yourself. You're getting it from somewhere else because it's in the passive voice. The action is happening to the subject. The subject's not doing the action. The action's happening to him. So in this case, be strong means I'm receiving this strength from somewhere else, or in this case, from someone else. Okay, and Paul says right away, in the Lord. And then, yes, the context bears this out because we talk about the armor of God, which comes from the Lord. Okay? All right, so this is a good example where we really need to understand what the verb is doing or we're going to misinterpret it. So if you're out there preaching and you say, brothers and sisters, are you strong? Are you making yourself strong? Are you mighty? Yes, you're a child of God. You can make yourself mighty in the Lord, you know, and you could preach. But you'd be telling them to do something that's opposite of what Paul was saying here. He wasn't saying, okay, everybody, you're going to be fighting the devil. You're going to be fighting Satan. You need to be strong. Are you working out? Are you making yourself strong? Are you taking your spiritual protein? You know, is that?
Hallelujah,
right? Praise God. But that's not what he's saying here at all. He's saying, brothers and sisters, you need to be strengthened, but that strength will not come from you. You need to find that strength, gain that strength, be empowered and strengthened by the Lord if you're to fight this battle. Now, how will that happen? Well, let me tell you. And then he goes on to the armor of God, putting on the armor of God. But it's really critical because you would take this verse, which is a verse that talks about really a grace of the Lord, that he is the one that will give you strength. And if you're not careful, if you misinterpret, you could twist it around and make it seem like this is something you have to do, that the strength comes from you. All right? And in English, it could be we use that way. I could say, Pastor Bobby, you need to be strong right now. And that could be a way for me to say, telling him, you need to make yourself strong. All right? So in English, be strong could be interpreted in an active way. But in the Greek, it's clearly telling us, no, this is passive. So that verb be is to try to help us understand that this is a passive thing, that this is the action happening to the subject. All right? Another very important example of this is in Ephesians 5:18. Be filled with the Spirit. Notice this too is an imperative. All right? Be filled. And notice it is passive. Be. So that tells us, and then the subject is you. So you need to be filled. And really, you could translate it by the Spirit. All right? So again, an example of, I don't fill myself. That would be a middle voice. And I'm not filling someone else. That would be active. It is you be filled. Someone else has to fill me. All right? Again, so critical we see this because we can't misinterpret this passage. I see so many people that, you know, take this verse and they talk about all these ways that you make yourself filled by the Spirit. You've got to pray. Brothers, are you praying for the Spirit to fill you now? You know, as if I'm in control of this, that I must do something that fills me. But clearly the command is, the Spirit is the one doing the filling. I need to put myself in the position to receive that filling. All right? I need to not hinder him. And that's a whole nother discussion we won't get into. But it's the same here with be strong in the Lord. It's not something I do. It's something done to me. But because it's a command, it's telling me I have to put myself in the position to receive that empowering. How do I do that? Well, Paul then says, put on the full armor of God. All right? Again, I'm not the one fighting, though. I'm being empowered to fight by God. Big, big difference. And I see a lot of error out there, with especially in spiritual warfare, where people are sort of taking on that I'm the one out, you know, fighting, and in the name of Jesus, you know, I command you to, you know, it's, what is that? What is that? That's not what's going on here at all. Yes, we confront evil forces. It's, you know, as Paul said, where our fight is not against flesh and blood. That's clear. But the way we do it, we better be correct and accurate in what Paul is instructing here. And I don't go out there and do the fight. I have to be empowered. And the way that happens is by putting on the armor of God. Okay?
Praise God.
Praise God. So as we look at this, there's one final characteristic of the verb. There's mood, there's voice, and then there's tense. And I think, right, this
now,
is just...
Now we are really tense, Pastor.
Yeah, James. Now you're tense. Okay. The tense is, in English, we have essentially three primary tenses, past, present, and future. Okay, so be strengthened is what tense here? Is this a past, future, or present?
It is present.
It's present
past
in this
tense.
Case.
Present.
Huh? It sounds past because of the ED here. But this is again where the interlinear would help us out. It said present tense. But yeah, that ED could be tricky. So this is a present command. It means make it yourself have as an ongoing condition or pursuit to be strengthened. So put yourself in an ongoing way to be empowered by the Lord. Make it your habit to do this. Present tense. All right. I'll talk about sort of past tense verbs at another time. because that carries a different kind of focus, that, but I don't want to distract here right now. So let me summarize, and then let me know if you have any questions. So when we look at verbs, we want to look for, again, three characteristics: the mood, the voice, and the tense. All right? If you can, especially the main verbs, if you can identify the characteristics of the main verb, and by that I mean the verb within the independent clause, that is critical to interpreting the meaning of the clause. Because again, actions drive the passage, all right? The verbs drive the passage. And if you can understand the verbs as much as possible, you're really, look at just this idea of be strengthened. Just by understanding it's a passive command tells us a lot, all right? Theologically even, you know, that we must get our strength from somewhere else. Yes, sir, Pastor Bobby.
The action, the verb drives the application.
Also, yeah, right? Exactly.
The application.
The action drives the application, right? Because this is a command as well, we're being told to do something, then we need to understand the nature of the command accurately. Now, what does it mean to be empowered? And again, how does that take place? Well, Paul tells us in this case, he says, and this is, let's carries us back to the, let me just cut and paste this passage here. All right, let's just, that was our little side trail. Let's go back to the text here. And if we look at this passage again, finally, be strong or be strengthened. And then he has in the Lord. Now, what is that in the Lord? Is that a clause or a phrase? Pastor Bobby, we're still with you.
It's a phrase, Pastor Tim.
It's a phrase.
Yes.
Why is it a phrase and not a clause?
Because it does not have a subject and a verb.
No subject or verb, it's all right?
No subject and a verb.
Okay. And how does it fit here?
It modifies the verb. It modifies be strong.
Oh, by the way, let me change the... Okay, there's no object here.
No object.
And the verb is be strong. It modifies, yeah, be strong by telling how to be strong. Yes. How do we receive this strength? How are we empowered? In the Lord or by the Lord. Okay? And then notice we have another. And in the strength of his might.
Mm-hmm.
What is...
Conjunction, and then the same under, in the strength of his might is so.
Is that a phrase or a clause?
Wrong, but this time now, Pastor Tim, okay?
Yes.
In the strength of his might, okay?
Yeah, let me just.
Is.
Keep going.
There's the conjunction there.
Yes, the word and.
Mm-hmm.
So that does what here? So we have another phrase in the strength. All right.
And then of his might is also a phrase. Okay. So we have two succeeding phrases.
Yes.
At modern is the same. Ah, it modifies strength.
Yeah, strength of his might. This is telling what kind of strength. Okay? So it modifies strength. And in the strength of, again, modifies be strong.
Yeah.
All right? Because notice, like you said, the and there. So if I were to diagram this, it would look like this. You be strong. And then we have those two phrases. In the Lord, right? Because that's telling me how to be strong. And in the strength.
Then under strength.
Of his might. Or which strength? Okay. Are you following me so far, guys? All right. So we found the independent clause right here, subject and verb. And again, as I said, when we looked at the interlinear, we realized it's the idea of be strengthened or empowered, okay? And then we found out in the Lord and in the strength of his might. All right? Now, let's go back to our passage here and just go one more verse. And let me ask Escarzon. We'll give Pastor Bobby a break now. Escarzon, we'll ask you to keep going with this. Good job, Pastor Bobby. Put on the full armor of God. Is this a phrase or a clause?
It's a clause, independent clause.
Very good. So we have another independent clause here. Okay. So I'll put the second one, independent. Put on the full armor. All right. What's the subject?
You imperative.
Again, you implied because the verb is
put on.
And is this a command? What's the mood? Let's talk about this verb. It's an imperative. What's the voice? Imperative. Passive or active?
Put on the full armor. It's an active.
Right, because it's saying you do the action. The subject does the action.
Yeah.
And then what's the tense? Here, present.
On the full armor.
Is it present, future, or past?
It's a present tense. Put on.
Okay, present tense. Okay, at least that's what it appears to be.
It looks like present tense.
It looks like.
Continuous.
All right.
Present tense continuous.
So we'll come to this, back to this in a minute. And then is there an object here?
No object.
Okay, so nothing's receiving the action or participating in the action?
Nothing.
Put on.
No object.
Okay, then what is the full armor here? Is that a phrase?
It's a phrase.
Okay. I'm going to push back on you a little bit. If it's a phrase, what is it modifying?
You put on.
Yeah, let's think about this sentence a minute. Okay, you got the verb, the subject and the verb. You put on, but notice the full armor is participating in the action. It's what you're putting on. So actually the object is the full armor.
That's
participating in the action. Yes. So the subject's doing the action or commanded to you. Put on is the action. And then He tells it what to put on, the full armor. So that's the object. That's participating or receiving the action. Okay? In this case. And then we have... What's that? I'm sorry, what did you say?
Of God.
Yeah, there's a phrase here. Of God. What is that? What is that modifying here?
Armor.
Armor.
Yeah, it's telling what kind of armor, right? Which armor?
Whose armor?
Whose armor? Whose or which armor? Okay.
Armor.
All right. And then we have so that you will be able to stand firm. Is that a phrase or a clause?
It's a phrase.
Okay, let's remember our definition. A phrase does not have a subject and a verb. Does this have a subject and a verb?
You will be able to stand.
Yeah, there's my subject, you, and we'll be able to stand as it's a extended verb, right? So we do have a subject and a verb here.
It's a clause.
So that means it's a clause. Now, here's the question. Is it dependent or independent? Does it stand alone?
It's a dependent clause.
Okay, and what tells you that? That's correct. What tells you it's dependent?
So that. Because yeah. The word so that.
Exactly. Very good. Excellent. Yeah, the so that, that's telling me this is connected to something else. It doesn't stand by itself as its own thought. The so that means, okay, I'll be able to stand is part of, it's modifying something else. And in this case, it's modifying put on. All right, so if I take this
put on
clause,
so you will be able to stand.
All right, this is telling us the purpose of the action put on. Why put on the full armor of God? So that you'll be able to stand firm. So here's how I would diagram this. Again, subject, right? We identified the independent clause. You put on the full armor.
The full armor.
Okay. There's my independent clause. I'll highlight it. Put on.
And of God.
Yep.
Under the armor.
Very good. Of God, because that's telling me which kind of armor or whose armor. All right, and then we had so that, and it's
under put on.
Why put on? All right, so notice a few things here. First, let me ask, does everybody follow me on this diagram? Are there any questions about this?
So, Pastor Tim, the phrase so that functions as, it's a clause, it's a phrase functioning as a conjunction.
Well,
be no purpose.
No, it's the whole thing is a clause here. All right. So that you will be able to stand firm.
Mm-hmm.
So that is my connector to something previously in the sentence. All right. When I diagram it, I separate it just because I like to separate these conjunctions.
So it doesn't function as a conjunction. There.
It does.
It does?
Yeah, it does. It's functioning as a conjunction, as a purpose statement. I just separate it out because I like to put my conjunction separate, like I did up here for and. You don't have to do that. You could have done this. That would be fine also to put it together. But I like to separate it out a little bit because it'll help me when I'm preaching. Because here I'll have, okay, now clearly I can see very clearly two ways that I'm to be strong. To be empowered in the Lord, in Christ, and in the strength of his might. Now, Paul could be saying the same thing and repeating for emphasis, or he could be identifying two distinct resources or ways that I am empowered. That would take more study to figure out which it is. So I separate out by the conjunction because it just helps me see it better. All right. Now, and so I do that here. So that is a conjunction, or therefore, because, for, in order that. Now, notice here, if I were to, this passage, we put the two independent clauses in parallel, right? Now, we didn't have an and here, did we, in the text? Mm-hmm. We look at the passage. Mm-hmm. There's no and here. He didn't say, and put on the full armor of God. He just said, put on the full armor of God. Mm-hmm. There's an implied and. Mm-hmm. Okay, these are two parallel commands. Just like if he had said, be strong and put on the full armor of God. Mm-hmm. Instead, he...
Series of command.
Yeah. And sometimes we'll have that too, where you'll have a series of commands or a series of statements. I ran home. I was tired. I went to bed. I could have said, I ran home and I was tired and I went to bed. Those would be three parallel actions or statements, sentences. But a lot of times you don't see that conjunction and. It'll just be, I ran home, I was tired, I went to bed.
So, Pastor Tim, so in diagramming, we consider both the construction of the English grammar and the construction of the interlinear.
Yeah, but do the English first.
Yeah, the English. That's my point, Pastor Tim. In the English construction, we have the ending with a period, and then it begins a new sentence. Put on.
Yes, there's a period after might here. Mm-hmm. Strength of his might, period.
Yeah.
And then
in,
you
in
put
the
on.
Greek, they have no period.
No. Not in the original. Mm-hmm. The original had no punctuation at all. Mm-hmm. Greek does have a semicolon, which functions as a period. You'll see in some Greek texts, but that's not in the original. The original had no punctuation. But clearly in the context here, Paul's giving two commands. They're in the same mood, the same voice, the same tense, and they're one right after the other. All right? So put on the full armor and you be strong. Those are two commands that Paul gives. All right? So if I were to be preaching on this passage, how many points would I have from this paragraph? Main points.
Oh, sir.
Two.
Oh.
Right? Mm-hmm. You be strong. And secondly, you put on the full armor. The first command is passive. This is something that is done to me. I need to be strengthened by the Lord and in the strength of his might. The second command is active. I need to also do something. I need to be something, receive something, and I need to be doing something. I need to be putting on the full armor of God. Why? So that I will be able to stand firm against the schemes of the devil. Okay? So here I just wanted to show you there's two parallel commands identified by these two independent clauses. They're tightly linked together. They're in the same paragraph. They're conveying two parallel commands that Paul is giving. All right? And if you look at the rest of the passage, for our struggle is not against flesh and blood. All right? That's connected to you will be able to stand firm. Why do I need to be able to stand firm? For our struggle is not against flesh and blood. Okay, this is why I need to stand firm. Okay.
Pastor Tim, could we pull it? But of course, we apply the principle as you taught us earlier to connect it to the nearest context, right? Connect it to the nearest
yes.
context.
Yeah,
but is it possible also we can stretch it all the way from the beginning to be strong?
You could, but you're so far away.
Uh-huh.
I think that Paul would have put this, be strong in the Lord for our struggles, not against flesh and blood.
Uh-huh.
I think it's be strong and put on the full armor. Why? So that you'll be able to stand firm against the schemes of the devil. I didn't put that in. Against.
So the nearest independent clause.
Yeah, that's the most, far most likely.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, doesn't mean it can't be up to be strong, but it's very unlikely. And it makes sense. Mm-hmm. Why do we need to be able to stand firm? Because our fight is not against flesh and blood. So we have to stand firm because we're in a fight. And to stand firm in that fight, who's the fight against? It's not flesh and blood. It's the principalities and powers. So we need to stand firm against that. How do we stand firm? By putting on the full armor of God and by being strong in the Lord. All right?
Mm-hmm.
So, all right, there's more phrases down here. Paul goes on, it's a long list. Rulers, powers, forces of this darkness. Those are references to spiritual forces. Okay, let me just do one thing really quick from this one because it's something different that'll show up in your passage in John. Let's take, Sir Sid, let me have you take this one. Just identify the independent clause here in Ephesians 4.
I, the prisoner of the Lord, implore you. I implore you.
There you go.
I implore you.
Yeah, now what's unique here is, okay, so give me the subject. No more.
I,
the verb.
Implore.
Okay, and do I have an object here?
Yes, it's a you.
Yeah, implore is an action. And the receiver of the act, the doer of the action is I, the receiver of the action is you. But we have something in between here, don't we?
Yes.
Is that a phrase or a clause?
It's a phrase.
Okay, and it's modifying what?
I.
Yeah. That's, modifies. Yeah.
A phrase describing noun, a positive.
Yes. It's a apposition. Good. A positive.
Apposition.
Yes.
Positive.
Hold on. Let me type out. So the prisoner of the Lord. The phrase modifies I, and yeah, we refer to this as an appositive, meaning it can be put in place of. Both are functioning as a subject, all right? So,
describing I.
So here's how I would diagram it. I, the prisoner of the Lord, is modifying the subject I, right? Technically, it's, right, which prisoner or whose prisoner. Okay. Modifies... I, the prisoner of the Lord, and then I have implore you. What do I do with this? Where does it go? How do I diagram something like this? Here's what I do. I draw a line to connect it. All right. So this tells me that this is part of my sentence. I implore you. There's my sentence. And the line just tells me this is where it completes the sentence. The subject is I, implore is the verb, and you is the object. Okay. Now, you could diagram it this way. I implore you. You keep the subject, verb, object on the same line and change the order. The prisoner. You could do it that way. All right, but I don't like changing the word order when I diagram because sometimes I accidentally leave a word out. Or if I want to read the phrase as it is given in the translation, I like to keep it in the same order. But what I do is this, I put this line in, it guides my eye, okay? So that I see that I have, here's my subject, and then the rest of my sentence is down here. Now, this is important because you'll notice Paul does this a lot. And we saw it actually in, did we talk about 1 John last week? Maybe that was another group.
No.
But we'll see it a lot where the sentence gets split up. In fact, if we go to let me just show you this passage here for a minute. For this reason, I too, having heard of the faith in the Lord Jesus which exists among you and your love for all the saints, do not cease giving thanks for you while making mention of you in my prayers. What is the independent clause here?
I, having heard
of you. So when I say independent clause, I'm looking for my main subject, verb, and object.
I do not cease giving thanks.
Yes. Very good. A plus. I do not cease giving thanks. All right. I, subject is I. The verb is do not cease. And in this case, the object is giving thanks. All right. This is a gerund, but it's that's the object. That's what's participating in the action, so to speak. I do not cease, sorry. But notice, so here's the subject, and then here's the verb and the object. But there's these phrases in between.
They are separated by a comma, so you can strike that out and retain the idea of the clause.
Yeah, so if you were to diagram this, it would be something like this. I would put to. Let me just diagram it for you, and then I'll explain it. Heard of the faith. All right. In the Lord Jesus. And of your love for all the saints. Okay. Do not cease giving thanks. Okay, let me talk about this. Now, what I'm doing is all right, here's my verb, do not cease. And I have This is modifying the action. Okay, why do I not cease giving thanks? Because having heard of your faith. Having heard of your faith, that's the reason I don't cease to give thanks. His motivation for prayer for them is their testimony. So as he heard of their testimony, he was motivated to give gratitude to God for them. All right? And I have in the Lord Jesus, because that describes what kind of faith. It looks like I'm going to have to. Okay. And there's two things he heard of, by the way. Their faith and their love. What kind of love? Or which love? Their love for all the saints. And then what I do is to guide my eye to show, to tell me the subject, the independent clause as I draw a line here. Okay? So that allows me to see, here's my independent clause, or you could highlight it like that. And then all this other stuff in between is just modifying phrases. Okay? This one modifies the verb because it's telling me why I do not cease. And then this phrase modifies faith. What kind of faith? This phrase modifies love. Which kind of love? Do not cease giving thanks. And then for you, and then we could keep going. But here is another example where the subject, verb, and object of the independent clause is split. And you have to search for it. Okay. Any questions on that? I know the nose, I'm seeing a little bit of the nose, the blood coming out of your noses. Just a little bit though. So you can survive another 20 minutes, I think. You have enough blood
Pastor
left.
Pastor Tim.
Yes.
Pastor Tim, the not is not part of the verb. It's an adverb. Not is always an adverb.
Yeah, but so I include it.
Doses for emphasis?
I include it because it gets complicated if I have too many single words separated. So it's part of the verb. Yeah, it's modifying the verb cease. But if you separate too many things, it sort of loses, the diagram loses its effectiveness. And it becomes more of a, are you familiar with sentence diagramming? Where, yeah. You know, you have a,
So Pastor Tim,
from that
answer, so what I get is we simplify it as best we can also.
Yeah, it's a tool. Mm-hmm. This is simply a tool. Here, let me just show you it. So a sentence diagram, well, I'm not going to draw very well, is where you have the subject,
verb,
object. And then you might have the modifiers, right?
Yes, link,
and then you could have the another modifier here, and it could be
okay,
right? And then it gets complicated. You separate it's a. This is an exercise in parts of speech.
Yeah,
I don't. This I don't think is as effective for Bible for exegetical work. This can be a lot of guys do this. A lot of guys I know do the sentence diagramming. So they would have, you know,
adjective there.
Yeah. Here would be like the.
The preposition.
Yeah. The man. I can't draw with this pen. I can't do this. The man. And then the verb would be here, hit. And then you'd have the ball here. How's this for 3-year-old handwriting. And then you'd have the underneath here, right? I don't know if you guys remember any of this, if you had to do it or not.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. This is helpful, just identifying parts of speech. And that's a good for grammar, but I don't think it's so helpful for what we're trying to do with the diagram. We're trying to see phrases as a whole.
That's for syntax.
Yes, for syntax. Okay, so I think it's sort of a combination. Yeah, so I put the word not here because if I just take that word out, I have to do, this is what I would be doing. All right, if you wanted to do that, you'd have do, you'd have not, you'd have cease, giving thanks. So now I got to put in another line.
To remind.
To tell me, okay, do goes to cease, and not is modifying the whole verb to cease. And let's see, I got to scoot this over, and there's my single word. So you see what's happening?
Complicated.
Yeah, and it begins to lose its effectiveness. And that's why even too, I sometimes put of, words with of on the same line. So if it's a negative, I just describe it as the negative of the verb. It's do not cease as opposed to do cease. So you are correct grammatically, Sid. As far as the diagram, I try to simplify it as much as I can so it can be helpful.
Thank you.
Pastor Tim.
Good question. Yeah.
What I do sometimes is, so if the sentence is complicated already like that, I go to the interlinear. For example, in that case, you will not find not in the, you will find not after cease in the interlinear. So I just balance the, what I was saying earlier, I just balance the English grammar construction with the Greek grammar construction in the interlinear and choose the best option to make it as simple as I can. So that's what I do many times.
Yeah, if we want to sort of, yeah, strike the balance between being helpful and being, you know, being accurate, but also, you know, it being a helpful tool. So if we go back to Ephesians, maybe I should do it this way. If we wanted to look at the interlinear here, let me go back to chapter 1. And then verse 15, I think it was. 13, 14, okay, 15.
Yes.
Okay. So if we just look at this, because of this, there's the having heard of the faith in the Lord Jesus, having heard of the love toward all the saints. And then here in the Greek, they put the negative, the adverb, in the beginning, before the verb. Do cease, I cease, and then not is, it's always put at the beginning of the. So, yeah, technically, and you see here it says adverb underneath. So technically, this word is modifying the verb. So technically, on a diagram, we should put it under the verb. But I keep it all together because it's the thought. It's the semantic, the idea. Do not cease. It's one verbal idea. So I keep it together so that otherwise it gets too complicated. Now, if you're not following us right now, don't worry about this, okay? Just do the convention that I'm doing here when I say, you know, put, if you have not, just put it with the verb. It's like we had the sentence earlier, the full armor of God. Technically, full modifies armor, and I should put it under the armor. But I just kept it on the same line. Again, just to keep things simple. All right?
Keep things simple. Don't follow us. We are confused and not preachers.
Okay. So let's let me do this. Let me go to, let's skip, we don't need to do that. Let's review a little bit of the diagramming process. All right. What we've done in the last few sessions together is I've tried to help you see that in the process of doing the diagram, we first look for the independent clause, or what I call the main sentence. The main subject, verb, and object. All right? And then we need to be able to identify which is the main independent clause and which are the dependent clauses or phrases. All right? So we've been spending the last few weeks just trying to get an understanding of phrases and clauses and what's the independent clause that I'm looking for. That's my main sentence. So in the last example, I do not cease giving thanks. Okay, I found that. That's helpful to know because in the diagram, that phrase, as we did up here, we start it to the far left. Okay, and then all my phrases and dependent clauses are going to be indented under the word, or above the word in this case, because this one's modifying, let me draw a little arrow here. This is modifying the verb, all right? So that's why I indented it inside the verb do cease, okay? But the idea is I find my main sentence, my independent clause, and then I identify the other phrases and clauses. Now, how do I do that? How do I know what is a phrase or clause? I mean, what's going to give me that clue? Well, that we're going to find those by identifying the phrases and clauses from connector words. Okay? So hopefully, now we're going to go back to where we started, really, three, four weeks ago. And that is, there are five categories of what I'll call connector words. All right, really, we should say, or symbols. I'll explain that in a minute. One set of connector words are conjunctions. Okay? Words like and, but. For, we saw another one, so that, because, therefore, since, although, in order that, okay, for this reason was another one. Okay, those are conjunctions, all right, they are connector words, And that's why, remember that phrase we had, so that you will be able to stand firm. And I think Escarzon said that this was a dependent clause because of the connector word, so that. It told us that this clause was not independent because there are these two connector words, this conjunction that tells us it's a purpose or a reason for something that was said earlier. And what was said earlier was put on the full armor of God. Why? So that you'll be able to stand firm. So here we identified this clause by the connector words, so that, the conjunction in this case. All right, so that's one type of what I call connector words.
Pastor Tim?
Yes.
You mentioned, I think, two lessons earlier. Or was it three? But you mentioned in our earlier lessons that sometimes they are independent clause. They have a subject. They have a predicate. But they make no sense standing alone.
Yeah.
I think this is one case which is like that, right?
Yeah, you will be able to stand firm. That needs, how will I be able to stand firm? Stand firm against what? I mean, it needs more to complete the thought, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then especially because I have a so that, that's telling me that this is not an independent thought. It's dependent on something else. Now, for me to say put on the armor of God, that is an independent thought. All right, it's self-contained. It's a complete thought. All right? And then we have, and that's what's connected to the so that.
And Pastor Tim, we go back to your lesson on the context in YouTube.
Yes.
We really have to evaluate and associate the clauses and the phrases depending on the context. Now, as you mentioned, context is king.
Yes, exactly. All right. And so they'll all be connected in some way. And what we want to do is try to find what are those independent clauses, the main subject and verb. All right. Because that will be the core from which all the other phrases and clauses are linked. Now, you may have a phrase like we did earlier here, where here I've got a phrase. Now, this phrase is not connected back to the main subject and verb, but it's connected to a word that is part of a phrase that's connected to the main verb. All right, so we'll have phrases and clauses all over the place, possibly, and they're going to be modifying potentially a word that's in another phrase or clause, not necessarily the main. So you could have some diagrams that have many phrases and clauses that are modifying things other than from the independent clause. But they're still all connected in some way. All right? So the diagram sort of helps us sort out and uncomplicate it a little bit. Because we can see, like I said, in the Lord Jesus, it's not talking about I or thanks. It's directly connected to the faith. Which faith? What kind of faith? Faith in the Lord Jesus, that faith. Or love for all the saints. This for all the saints doesn't go to I. It doesn't modify the verb. It's modifying here which kind of love. It's not just any love. Paul's referring to a specific love, the love for all the saints, that love in this context. Okay? So, but what we need to be able to do is identify each and every phrase. And so to do that, we're back to, we have to understand or identify first conjunctions. Okay? Another connector word, prepositions. And there's a lot of these. In your handout, I'll give you a link to where you can find a list of them. All right? I won't put the link here, but you'll find it on the handout. Prepositions, right? This is by, with, in, through, above, right? Around. There's lots of these. Okay? I won't list them all. Like I said, you can look them up. I'll give you a link. You can look up the list of them. But they also are a connector word that identifies a phrase for us. So, for example, I hit the ball with the bat. We have the main subject, verb, and object here. But then we have this phrase, and it's identified by the connector word with, the preposition. And in this case, it's how I hit the ball with the bat. All right? So we have connector words, conjunctions, prepositions. We have a third type, which is called the relative pronoun. And there's just a few of these, which, that, who or whom. All right. So the man who was old, had or walked with a cane. All right, so we have the man is the subject, walked is my verb. All right, there's no object here. And then I have who was old. That modifies which man, all right, who. All right, so I put it under man. And he walked with a cane. That's how he walked. And again, notice the preposition with. All right, so I have the man is one, or the who was old is my phrase. The man walked and with a cane is another phrase. These two phrases are identified by their connector words. Okay? So, we have three types of connector words so far. We have conjunctions, prepositions, and then relative pronouns. All right, there's a fourth kind of connector word, participle. That's the verb, usually is a verb plus ing, sometimes maybe ed. Okay? And we just saw one. I, having heard of the faith, do not cease giving thanks. Okay? Having heard of the faith. Having heard is my participle. All right? So this participle tells me I have a phrase here. And in this case, the phrase modifies the verb. It's telling that why I do not cease giving thanks. So look for participles. Those will identify a phrase in the passage. And then finally, another way, and this is where it's not a connector word, it's really a symbol, is look for the punctuation. Right? A period, comma, semicolon, right? Question mark. Colon. All right, these will help you note, you can use that to identify a phrase or a clause. All right, now this is interpretive. Again, there's no punctuation in the original Greek, but the English translations will put it in, and they can be helpful. I think Sid mentioned before in that sentence above, there was a comma. I, too, and the comma here was helpful. But we saw the phrase from the participle. So notice here, we have one phrase introduced by the participle. We have another phrase introduced by in. We have another phrase introduced by which. You see that? So the connector words are going to help us identify the phrases and clauses. So next week, when we get back together, we will break down the verse and identify all the phrases and clauses in the verse. And then we go back and go, okay, now how do they connect to each other? All right? Okay, that's enough. You've lost enough blood from your noses.
Pastor Tim, that will be syntax and analysis.
Basically, that's what a diagram is. It's sort of a syntactic
after analyzing, analysis. You put it back together.
Yeah. All right. So we'll break it apart and then we'll put it back together, identifying how everything is linked together. All right. So hopefully things will, at this point, when we start doing the diagram for John and going through this process here, it will, hopefully this will come full circle. But I wanted to spend a little bit of time giving the foundation for sentences and phrases and clauses so that we can be prepared for the diagramming, which essentially is just identifying those phrases and clauses and then figuring out how they are linked together.
Yeah.
Okay. Pastor and then Tim, showing that in a diagram. Yes, sir.
Pastor Tim, we appreciate very much helping us out in developing our proficiency to be able to go about the identifying and the diagramming of the English translation. Because just to point out significance to the rest of us, the English translation has a high degree of reliability already because it has been worked on by scholars translating it from the original language to make sense in the English. So the English translation has, at least the reliable translations, as you mentioned, NASB, the ESB, and the others, NIV, and now the Net Bible, they have great reliability already because it has been worked on by scholars from the original text, right?
Pastor yeah, Ken? And it's exactly, and actually it will prepare you if you decide at some point to go on to actually study the Greek or the Hebrew, this will prepare you for that because you're going to find you're going to have the same things in the Greek. If you were to diagram in the Greek, you'd be looking for phrases. Those phrases will be introduced by the Greek has prepositions. It has conjunctions. It has participles. And so you'd be doing the exact same process. It's just in the Greek text. So, you know, one, the English translations we have are very good. And for the most part, not always, as we saw a moment ago, be strong is not as good a translation as be strengthened. So we went to the interlinear and that helped us a little bit. So we'll have those times where it's not perfect, but they're very good translations. Start there. Don't worry about the interlinear at the beginning. Just do the English translation you have. But that process will be the exact same process you would go through if you were going to diagram in the original language. All right. And so that's why we want a good literal translation that tries to closely match the original. And so the New American Standard for English is among the better ones. ESV is good as well. For the Greek text, probably the best for Hebrew would be the New King James. It's probably a little better. But New American Standard is also very fine, the Old Testament. New American Standard or ESV are two good English translations to use for what we're doing here. And it's not like it would be wasted effort if you continued on to Greek, it would be that step towards Greek. Now, Greek is a little more complicated. Like I said, it has three voices. And when you look at the verb tenses, there's like seven verb tenses in Greek. So Greek is the same thought process, just more a little more complicated. Yeah, Pastor Bobby.
We're looking forward because you kind of held back a while back, not to complicate things with us, you held back on explaining the details of the tenses. So for my little understanding, because I think because of your understanding that the tenses are complicated. For example, in the English grammar, you have past, present, and future tenses. But that doesn't necessarily apply in the Greek tenses, right?
Yeah, the Greek tenses, there's really not a past tense in Greek. There's an aorist tense.
There's the aorist tense.
But it's not exactly a past tense. It's translated often past tense. But it has more of an idea of a looking at an action from the outside as a whole. So it affects, like, for example, an imperative in the present tense. If it's a present imperative, has the idea of make this your habit. But if it's an aorist imperative, it means do it now. Yeah. Like an immediate, do this now. So for example, put on the full armor of God is actually aorist. So it's not a past tense. It's this idea of do it now, urgency. Present tense, it would still be a command, but it'd be the idea of make this your habit, do this continually. Whereas an aorist imperative has the idea of do this now. This is an urgent instruction. So there is a, in Greek, there are some slight differences that you're going to want to understand when you are considering this. Another
In the English grammar, present is sometimes simple present only. Now, it's happening now. If you go to the Greek, present is not simple as happening just now. It's, as you mentioned, it continues.
Yeah, there's different types of the present tense. And then in Greek, you've got perfect tense, pluperfect, imperfect, future. So it's a little bit more complicated. But that's why I'm saying doing this for English is a good step towards better understanding how Greek grammar works. So if you want to, I'm just telling you that by way of an encouragement that this isn't a waste of time. One, because, you know, English, there's a lot of good work out there in English, so it can be helpful. But two, if you do at some point go in a more advanced into the Greek, you're being prepared for some parts of that. Greek, you're going to have to consider, you know, the tense and the mood and the voice because the way the Greek verb is set up, it you can see just by looking at the Greek verb, it'll have a different way that it's spelled out or conjugated depending on its mood, its voice, and its tense. And so if you understand that concept now, that'll just help you a lot when you look at Greek and even Hebrew. Hebrew is only has two tenses, perfect and imperfect. You'd think that would make it easier. It actually makes it harder because it's not perfect is not just a past tense. It describes the type of action. An imperfect tense in Hebrew describes the type of action. So it's actually more complicated, believe it or not. That's why some guys do really well in Greek and bad poorly in Hebrew, just because it's a different, the language functions a little differently. So anyway, that's something for, you know, in the future we can look at as well. You know, so the interlinear is a helpful tool to be able to get familiar with. Just be very careful with it because you can, it tells you some things, but it doesn't tell you everything. And until you really have studied the Greek or Hebrew text or language, you just want to be cautious that you're not too definitive sometimes with that. So, but that doesn't mean we should avoid it. We, you know, an interlinear tool can be very helpful to us in our study if we use it in the right way. All right. So, and one way that I would recommend you use it is just to check the verbs and see what the Greek tells you as far as the mood and the voice, because it'll tell you active imperative, you know, passive participle, those kinds of things. All right. So next week Lord willing, we'll pick it up right here with the diagramming, and then we'll actually go into John 4 and probably do the passage on Jesus talked about true worship. We'll break that down, then we'll go to the next step, textual observation, and then move towards the getting to the sermon, what, why, how, the author's what, why, how. Okay? Okay. I've caused enough suffering for you today. I'll let you get some rest. Okay. What's that?
We're going to take a vacation. In Camiguin.
All right. Anselmo, Brother Anselmo, can I ask you to close our time together in prayer?
Okay, let us pray.
Thank you.
Our great and loving Father, once again, thank you for this art.